Hello everyone, today's topic is anaphylaxis in dental practice, an updated version. I'm Dr. Mohana Priya Michaels, voice behind Dental Shots. If you have not subscribed to our channel, kindly click the subscribe button and don't forget to hit the bell button. Let's move on to the video. Anaphylaxis is a life-threatening emergency. The new cases of anaphylaxis are increasing day by day. The anaphylaxis need to be promptly addressed by administration of adrenaline, which will determine the survival of the patient. So the general dental practitioners should be competent enough to inject the adrenaline in the intramuscular route with the help of a syringe and needle. The definition of anaphylaxis is a severe, potentially life-threatening generalized allergic reaction, rapidly developing symptoms and signs, skin changes such as redness and itching, mucosal changes like swelling below the skin surface, swallowing and breathing difficulty due to swollen mouth, throat or tongue, wheezing, tachypnea, tachycardia and hypotension. So what are the causes of anaphylaxis, especially in dental practice? That's what we are going to see. First is antibiotics may be the reason for anaphylaxis. The chlorhexidine, which we use in a day-to-day practice, may be the cause of anaphylaxis. Local anesthetic agent, which is the bread and butter for the dental surgeon, would be a reason for anaphylaxis. General anesthetic or latex allergy, toothpaste can cause anaphylaxis. And iodoform or povidone iodine can also cause an anaphylaxis. Let's see one by one in detail. The antibiotics most likely to cause anaphylaxis. Commonly, we use three antibiotics in dentistry, namely amoxicillin, phenoxymethylpenicillin and metronidazole, among which the amoxicillin is probably the one of the most commonly associated with anaphylaxis. Death from anaphylactic reaction to amoxicillin have been reported in many cases. The next cause is the chlorhexidine, which is an effective antiseptic used in dentistry. Present in most of the mouthwashes, toothpaste and dental implants also contain chlorhexidine. So however, the anaphylaxis to chlorhexidine has been increasingly reported worldwide. So the proper history will avoid this anaphylaxis due to chlorhexidine. So let's see a case report related to anaphylaxis caused by chlorhexidine. Once there was a patient who underwent a recent tooth extraction, and irrigating that socket, the recently extracted socket, with the chlorhexidine resulted in the death of two patients, which was reported. And this raised an awareness about the risk of anaphylaxis to the products containing chlorhexidine. And in this COVID period, when a patient asks you through the phone without contacting you, they are going to use the chlorhexidine in their home. So advise them to rinse with the warm salt water rather than advising them for a chlorhexidine if they are suffering from dry socket followed by extraction. Next product used in dentistry which leads to anaphylaxis in certain conditions are local anesthetic agent. It's very rare when you use an amide local anesthesia like mepivacaine or plain prilocaine, but it is common in ester local anesthetic agent because it is metabolized into a para-aminobenzoic acid, a known allergenic compound. Not only the ester local anesthetic agent, even the preservatives used such as benzoates in a multi-dose vials, and also the antioxidant like metabisulfate in a LA solution can cause a local anaphylaxis. Most of the dentists feel that the general anesthesia mostly doesn't cause anaphylaxis, but it is not uncommon. A number of cases in oral surgery in theaters have been reported with anaphylaxis by using a general anesthetic agent. The next cause of anaphylaxis is the latex allergy, which is increasingly common nowadays. So let's see the prevalence, the average prevalence among each and every people. First would be 9.7% in healthcare workers, followed by susceptible patients 7.2% and general patient population it's 4.3%. So there are a lot of studies which says that if a person is suffering from spina bifida, then they have a chance of 67% of latex allergy. When you have a patient saying that they have an existing allergy to elastoplast or an allergy to banana, kiwi or avocado, they are more prone for latex allergy also. So you have to be cautious enough when taking an history. Then even the asthmatic patients will have a severe reaction to a latex allergy. So using a latex-free product whenever possible should be an ideal thing in dental practice. So most of the dentists think that the latex is only present in gloves and they will just switch over to their vinyl gloves. But that is not the case. There are guidance which has been published stating that the presence of latex in various dental products, so that if a patient gives you a history of latex allergy, then you are in a position to use a latex-free alternatives to that dental product. This tabular column will give you a wide knowledge, stating that the first column tells you the dental equipments which has a latex in it and what are the alternatives that you can use. It is in the second column, and the third column gives you a manufacturing details of alternative latex products. So even the amalgam carrier has a latex in it, and aspirators, Bunsen burner tubings, dental dam, and endodontic stops, and elastics used in orthodontics, mixing bowls used for alginate bowls, and polishing equipments as latex, and temporary crowns and matrix also has latex. So this not only a gloves has a latex, you have to understand the lot of products which we use in day-to-day practice of dentistry has a latex, and we have to really know what are the products which has a latex and what are the products we can alternatively use if a patient says that they are allergic to a latex. And this knowledge should be shared with your colleagues also, so that you can prevent anaphylaxis and save a life on a dental chair who are experiencing a latex allergy. Even a toothpaste can cause anaphylaxis, so be very sure about the history which was being given by the patient and correlate with your prescription before writing a toothpaste. So even a fatal anaphylaxis has been reported when a patient used a toothpaste. So case report in US, a young person who gives a history of allergy to dairy products, a dentist wrote a prescription of a toothpaste containing Recaldent, which is a milk derived protein, which has been recommended by her dentist only. So he developed an anaphylaxis and died on using a toothpaste. So be very sure about the history before even prescribing a toothpaste too. Let's see one more case report which has been reported in Australia. A child with a history of milk allergy. During a dental treatment, the dentist used a tooth mouse which contains a Recaldent, and child developed anaphylaxis, and the child began to complain the discomfort in her mouth and progressed into a difficulty in swallowing. And since the child has prompted her and alerted her mother to administer the adrenaline immediately by the use of automated adrenaline injection, the life of the child has been rescued in a very prompt manner. Next product is the iodoform leading to anaphylaxis. The endodontic product including Alvogel contains iodoform. So the Alvogel product information stipulates that it should not be used in patients with a known allergy to procaine, novocaine type anesthetic, iodine or compound related to iodine. So you have to be sure that the patient is not allergic to iodine or provocaine or any iodine related products. Okay, so Alvogel should not be used when a patient gives a history of allergy to iodine. So far we saw about the products which related to the anaphylaxis in dental practice. Now we will be seeing about the clinical features and how to diagnose anaphylaxis. It's a quick onset and rapid deterioration of a patient. As soon as possible, the detailed history has to be taken and patient has to be assessed and treated in the ABCDE approach to help the recognition and initial diagnosis of anaphylaxis. In the ABCDE approach, the first A is the airway. The sign and symptom related to it are swollen tongue, difficulty swallowing and speaking, throat tightness, hoarse voice, stridor. And breathing signs and symptoms are difficult in noisy breathing, chest tightness, persistent coughing, wheezing, tachypnea. And circulation related signs and symptoms are hypotension, tachycardia, pallor and collapse. And disability signs and symptoms of feeling dizzy or faint, confusion, agitation, syncope and loss of consciousness. And exposure related signs and symptoms are skin changes like urticaria, angioedema, erythema, rhinitis, conjunctivitis, abdominal pain and cramps, and nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, sense of impending doom. To easily identify whether it is an anaphylaxis, it has to satisfy three criteria. First one, it should be a sudden onset, rapid progression of symptoms, as I mentioned earlier, the symptoms A, B, C, D, E, and the life-threatening airway or breathing or circulation problems, and skin and mucosal changes. If you see these three criteria, if you see, it would be, you should be sure it's an anaphylaxis and start administering adrenaline as soon as possible. Sometimes there may be a chance of mistaken diagnosis, like it would be a panic attack or vasovagal attack, but you diagnose it to be an anaphylaxis. To prevent that, we have to know about these two things. The panic attack has a hyperventilation, tachycardia, anxiety related erythematous red rash. So the absence of urticaria, hypotension, pallor, dyspnea helps to exclude the anaphylaxis. And in the same time, the vasovagal syncope has pallor, sweating, hypotension, nausea, vomiting and bradycardia. See, the absence of rash and tachycardia, dyspnea helps to exclude the anaphylaxis. Next, we will be seeing about the adrenaline, which is the most important drug in anaphylaxis. It has to be administered promptly. Any delay in administration of adrenaline will increase the risk of death. So failure to give an adrenaline is the most common cause of death associated with anaphylaxis. A study of a UK registry said that 40% of all death due to anaphylaxis is, the reason is adrenaline has not been administered. Next, we will see the actions of adrenaline. It reverses the peripheral vasodilatation, reduces the edema, dilates the airway, increases the myocardial contractility, suppresses the histamine and leukotriene release. Next, we will see about the dose recommended. In adult, it is about 0.5 ml of 1:1000. Adrenaline concentration, and in child, if they are greater than 12 years, it is 500 micrograms IM 0.5 ml. If a child is 6 to 12 years, it is 300 microgram IM, that is 0.3 ml of 1:1000 concentration of adrenaline. So now you do know the dose, and the main thing is do not delay to expose the bare skin. When you see an anaphylactic case, it's a life-threatening situation. Time is very critical in anaphylaxis situation in dental practice. So injection through clothings in the IM route is, it would be fine. Don't need to delay to expose the bare skin. So take care and avoid the seam in the trouser so that your injection is not penetrating well. And also the items in the patient's pocket should also be considered when you are injecting through clothing. So the next big question is, if a patient is allergic to adrenaline, what we should do? So this case is very rare. A patient allergic to adrenaline is very rare. Though they are allergic to adrenaline, they are not absolutely allergic to adrenaline. That would be the hypersensitivity reaction to sodium metabisulfate, which is a preservative used in adrenaline vial in 1:1000 solutions. So the adrenaline should still be administered to the patient in anaphylaxis who has the hypersensitivity to the sodium metabisulfate, as needed for the life-saving drug far outweighs any theoretical risk for sulfates. So don't think about the allergic to adrenaline. Go ahead and give an IM adrenaline 1:2000 ratio. So you can either load it from the ampule, or they are auto injectors. Adrenaline auto injectors are also available. They are quick to use and relatively easy to use when compared to loading an adrenaline. This can be bought in your clinic and kept. So always be ready with these things, because you don't know which patient will have an anaphylaxis and which would be a bad day for you. So be ready with adrenaline 1:1000, 1 milligram and 1 ml ampule. At least 2 should be present. And you should have a 23 gauge needle of 25 mm long, which is 4 in number. And also a 38 mm needle may be needed if a patient with a very fat and obese patient, if they are, then you need a longer needle that should also be available. And you should have a 1 ml syringe graduated needle should also be available. So safety needle should be ideally used for IM injections to reduce the needle stick injury. So the next question is, which muscle should I inject a IM injection of adrenaline? So there's a separate video which I have been uploaded related to A to Z about the intramuscular injection, so you can watch that also. But in particular for anaphylaxis, we always recommend you to put a IM injection in vastus lateralis muscle in a thigh, because the high drug plasma level is achieved when you give in this particular area within minutes. The deltoid muscle is not recommended because the rate of absorption of adrenaline in this site is very low. Though it is very easy to access to other areas, the deltoid muscle doesn't absorb the adrenaline properly. So we have to choose vastus lateralis. There are recent changes which has been recommended when giving your IM adrenaline during anaphylaxis. It's not like a normal IM injection. You need not follow a lot of rules and regulations. No need to wear a gloves in that particular time. You are in a life-threatening situation. And the alcohol swab to clean the skin is no longer recommended or necessary. Or to leave a gap between the hub and the skin is not necessary. Because leaving a distance between the hub and the skin may be you are injecting in a subcutaneous tract rather than the muscle, so that gap is not needed. And aspirating and drawing back the syringe is no longer advised, since the IM injection is given in the thigh region where the blood vessel is not very high. And massaging the site following the injection is no longer advocated, because in the muscle area the adrenaline get dissipated. If you are loading from the glass adrenaline ampule, ideally you have to use a paper towel or a piece of a gauze to protect the fingers and thumbs from the glass injury. Alternatively, you can use an ampule opening device. If not possible, always apply a pressure in the neck of the ampule and apply pressure away from the colored dot and never in the other direction. So apply a sufficient light pressure to snap the top of the ampule, and do not apply any pressure to the base of the ampule, which may cause a shattering of glass. And avoid pulling or twisting action which may apply pressure to the glass ampule. And if the glass does shatter, the broken glass and contents will need to be carefully discarded and another ampule has to be used. So the IM injection of adrenaline in anaphylaxis, you have to expose the thigh vastus lateralis. If not possible, inject through the clothings and use a non-dominant hand to taut the skin, and this will displace the subcutaneous fat in the injection site so that the solution gets inside the muscle as such. And also advise the patient to tense the opposite leg so that they will relax the leg where you are injecting, and insert the needle 90 degree angle, and wait for 2 seconds before you are removing the syringe from the needle from that place, so that the drug diffuses into the tissue and doesn't flow back to the orifice. And also withdraw the needle rapidly and dispose the sharp safely, and draw up another dose of adrenaline. In that case, if they are not responding within 5 minutes, you can give a second dose. To summarize, first, the anaphylactic reaction you have to confirm by seeing the criteria as A, B, C, D, E. And after the diagnosis, you have to call for help and lie the patient flat and raise the patient's leg. And intramuscular adrenaline has to be administered. And the dosage, as I earlier mentioned, is different for adults and children who are greater than 12 years, 6 to 12 years. And if the patient is less than 6 years, it's 150 microgram, that is 0.15 ml. So act vigilantly when a patient collapses on your chair. Give adrenaline, the life-saving drug. I hope this updated version of anaphylaxis in dental practice would be helpful for your future practice. And do share this video with your dental colleagues and friends. And have a great day. I hope you like the video. If you like, click the like button and kindly subscribe to Dental Shorts for further notification of new videos. Thank you. Have a great day. God bless you all.